Riding along on a carousel, will I catch up to you? Horses chasing, cause they're racing, so near yet so far. On a carousel.
As a member of the British invasion group, the Hollies, Nash had toured extensively in the US and been deeply affected by his experiences, particularly in the Californian music milieu. The Hollies were in essence and instinct a straight-laced, chart-oriented pop act with little time for the progressive and radical tropes of the American counterculture. But Nash was fascinated. During the course of visits to Los Angeles, he had developed close friendships with both David Crosby and Cass Elliot of the Mamas and the Papas and took occasional breaks from his Hollies duties to spend time hanging out in Laurel Canyon. Nash's affinity with the scene across the Atlantic had a profound impact on his songwriting and sense of ambition. His image began to morph from Manchester to Haight-Ashbury, and his compositions became more adult and ethereal than the Hollies' traditional boy-girl fare. Nash was evolving, and his relationships with both his bandmates and his wife started to suffer.
It was a strange lot with the Hollies. It was that strange period where pop was evolving into rock, and it was, for certain groups, it was impossible to make that transition without effectively destroying your career. And it's interesting to see their garb. I mean, in 67, they're going around in caftans, particularly Graham Nash. He's going around in caftans and he's in the Hollies. And he was in a suit only 2 years before. But now he looks like the hippie. And the Hollies albums were becoming slightly psychedelic, but not really. It was like the toe in the water. And Nash's problem, of course, was that none of the others in the group wanted to do that. They were too aware of what their real role was, which was a commercial pop group. Even more crucial than the songwriting issue was the fact that Nash took drugs and they didn't. And I think that just brought a different sensibility to the whole thing. And for Nash, it was a question of pushing forward. And for the Hollies, it was a question of maintaining their career.
If you could only see me.
The uneasy coexistence between Nash's ambition and the Hollies' career concerns collapsed in the summer of 67 with the release of a new single, King Midas in Reverse. The band had agreed to indulge Nash's new direction with the song, and when it only scraped into the UK top 20, a disaster by Hollies standards, they held it as evidence that a move towards a West Coast rock sound was entirely misconceived. The group effected an immediate volte-face, recording a slew of disposable pop hits and ignoring Nash's compositions entirely.
When King Midas in Reverse came out, it was a critical success, huge success critically. But chart-wise, nothing. A bomb. And so I had to take the brunt of that, you know, from my band. You know, they'd followed me down this path, and to them I'd led them down the wrong path. And so that it was at that point in my career with the Hollies that I began to realize that we're not on the same page and I have to do something about this.
King Midas in Reverse, which was a song that David Crosby heard and said, oh, this guy's got another kind of throat, you know? I mean, that really impressed David. So by the time they were meeting and hooking up through Mama Cass, you know, they had already admired each other.
Though alienated from the Hollies, Graham Nash had won many fans in Laurel Canyon. In the summer of 1968, he took a break from the stifling atmosphere back in England and traveled to Cass Elliot's home in LA. During a jam session in the canyon, Nash added his voice to a three-part harmony with Stephen Stills and David Crosby, and a route out of the Hollies presented itself. Stills and Crosby had been loosely working together over the preceding months, recording demos of each other's material and discussing the potential of a joint project. But after singing with Nash, they instantly perceived a bright future as a trio.
He was writing really good songs. Marrakesh Express, Right Between the Eyes, Lady of the Island. I mean, beautiful stuff. Beautiful stuff.
David and I had been hanging together for a while, and we were sort of figuring out what to do next. And turns out Nash is kind of, he's real frustrated, right? So we finally, he said, would you like to come and play with us? And he said, oh, yes.
I saw Nash's final concert with the Hollies, which is Save Rave at the London Palladium. And I never knew it, but Crosby was in the, you know, was in the building. He'd come over to whisk him away. So probably, possibly Stills was there. I know Crosby was definitely there at it. He went to the dressing room, and don't think the Hollies were too pleased about that. They're all in the white suits, and they looked quite old-fashioned. And it was very, very slick, very, very slick, very impressive. But it was like the old world. And it's just amazing to think within days of that, that Graham Nash is suddenly in another country. You know, he's left his wife, his home, his group, and he's completely reinvented himself overnight. Listen to me, I'll sing a song to change your mind. Your ears are deaf, your mouth is dumb, your eyes are blind. Listen to me, and very soon I think you'll find somebody wants to help you, somebody seems to care. And very soon you've forgotten that you'd care about you. To this day, it's the life-transforming, you know, the moment for him. It changed everything for him. It changed his whole life. It changed his whole career. And, you know, his music thereafter went in a completely different direction. Apart from the fact he never did quite lose that the commercial nous that he had with the Hollies.
Crosby and Stills returned from London with Nash liberated from the Hollies and ready to begin a new life in Laurel Canyon. But questions remained over how exactly the band would be formulated. They had agreed at the outset that they would not be a band at all. Having recently emerged from the fraught relationships and unhappy divorces of their respective groups, all were keen to preserve the new singer-songwriter ethos of individuality, independence, and self-expression. Crosby stated publicly that they should be viewed as an aggregate of friends, governed by consent rather than contracts, and able to pursue other projects, disband and reform as the mood took them. After inviting the young and ambitious management duo of David Geffen and Elliot Roberts to represent them, the group pitched to Ahmet Ertegun and Atlantic Records, who was willing to take a chance on the basis of their demos and pulled strings to release Nash from his Hollies era contract with EMI. The trio had performed sporadically at friends' houses and local gatherings, where their distinctive harmonies had been unanimously praised by the Canyon set and had even experimented with recording, but their sound remained undefined. Nash had assumed that they would record an acoustic album, but Stills was keen to have an electric element and retain a rock and roll edge. His vision prevailed, and drummer Dallas Taylor was asked to join the band.
Their original intent was to just do like a Peter, Paul and Mary record, no electric, just acoustic, you know, and in fact, that was what they really liked about me, is that I could play along with, I could play the song, you know, I played the song. You know, they thought my parts were, I mean, we were all on the same level at that point.
With Taylor on board, the band went straight into recording. Having exhaustively rehearsed their songs over the preceding months, the challenge was to capture their particular blend on tape while filling out the arrangements and working in the electric element. And to this end, they booked a session with engineer Bill Halverson at Wally Hyder's studios in LA.
I'm not sure we were looking for a particular sound. I think Stephen wanted his acoustic guitar to sound good, and obviously the vocals. And somewhere they found Bill Halverson. And I think Bill actually became another member of the band, because he was so in tune to what we were doing that he knew, you know, we'd just play. And he knew when to press the red button and when to not press the red button, and caught all these magical takes.
First night of the sessions, or afternoon, they show up with a couple guitars and a bass and, you know, in David's VW bus, the three of them. You know, we're just sort of, okay, now what are we gonna do? Well, Steven's gonna play some guitar. And so I set up a guitar mic, set up a Neumann U67, and got him a chair, and he wants the lights turned out, so I turned out the lights so I can't see him. And Crosby and Nash are in the booth with me. And then Stephen starts playing. He's doing the basic track to Sweet Judy Blue Eyes. And I'm going, it's horrible. I'm done.
It's getting to the point where I have no fun anymore. I'm sorry. Sometimes it hurts so badly I must cry out loud. I'm lonely.
So I'm adding all this top end and I'm taking off the bottom and put a compressor on it and I just keep, and it's just so bright, so over-compressed, there wasn't any bottom end. You could just hear the compressor just laid down. It wasn't even bouncing, it just died. So my life's going before me and I'm making excuses to myself. And he's just playing and it just wouldn't stop. And so when he finally it stops, I've made up all these excuses in my mind how to tell him I can do better and yada, yada. And so they meet each other at the door and they're high-fiving and he comes in and he says, that's the guitar sound I've been looking for, you know. And I just went, thanks. Then we want to sing. I'd gotten a lot of experience at Hyder's. Singer is getting around one microphone. And so I just took the Neumann 67 and raised it up, opened it all the way around, and got two more sets of headphones and went, okay, so sing. And I had no idea where we were going.
The album sessions were dominated by Stephen Stills, who assumed the role of an informal creative director. Though Crosby and Nash had input on their respective songs and contributed heavily to the vocal arrangements, Stills worked tirelessly on the music and instrumentation, routinely pushing on through the night.
Stephen, I want to play bass, and then I want to play electric, and then I want to play organ, and then I want to play, and I want to play. That built it. It was more what was in Stephen's mind. I'm just tagging along, trying not to mess it up. And so I didn't have a preconceived idea of where it was going at all. Take, for instance, Guinevere. Guinevere, Dallas by that time is there, and he wants to play it with drums, and we did a couple versions with drums and one without, and then the version we end up using is with drums, but then all of a sudden David and everybody didn't want the drums, and it was forever trying, because everybody's out in the room together, and it was a good room, and I didn't use any baffles or anything, and to filter out and to get rid of the drum leakage, I can hear it in a couple of places. Stephen had energy that would go all night. And I got so I could do that with him.
He was an amazing spectacle to watch. To watch him build those tracks, he played almost every instrument on every track. Maybe not Lady of the Island, and he certainly got David to play guitar on Long Time Gone. And David, of course, played guitar on Guinevere. The rest pretty much is Stephen. Bass, organ, piano, lead guitar. It was Stephen. We called him Captain Many Hands. He could do anything.
There's one part on, I think, Long Time Gone, where David Crosby, he just had a part he had to put on there. And he was out there for hours and just trying to put this part on. He'd take a break and we'd go do something else and then he'd go back to it. And finally, I think he finally laid down on the couch and Stephen went out there and just played it. And we didn't tell him.